Alleluia, give thanks to the risen Lord. Alleluia, alleluia, give praise to his name.
Alleluia, alleluia, give thanks to the risen Lord. Alleluia, alleluia, give praise to his name. Jesus is Lord of all the earth. He is the King of creation. Alleluia, alleluia, give thanks to the risen Lord. Alleluia, alleluia, give praise to his name.
Spread the good news o'er all the earth. Jesus has died and has risen.
Alleluia, alleluia, give thanks to the risen Lord. Alleluia, alleluia, give praise to his name. We have been crucified with Christ. Now we shall live forever. Alleluia. Alleluia, alleluia, give praise to his name. Come, let us praise the living God, joyfully sing to our Savior. Alleluia, alleluia, give thanks to the risen Lord. Alleluia,
Psalm 133 proclaims how good and pleasant it is when kindred live together in unity. I'm Ryan Irmer, I'm the pastor at Slackwood Presbyterian Church, and I want to welcome you to worship today. We are so glad that you are with us, that you are joining us. This is the fourth collaborative worship service that we have been able to put together in and through the Presbytery of New Brunswick. And each and every time, I am amazed with the unique gifts and talents that each individual has and how those come together for us to be one united body of believers where we have the ability and the opportunity to worship and praise the triune God. And so I want to invite you at this time to join me in our call to worship as printed in your bulletin. Let us worship God.
Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth.
All who worship God, come here and listen. I will tell you everything God has done for me.
I prayed to the Lord, and I praised God.
If my thoughts had been sinful, God would have refused to listen.
But God did listen and answered my prayer.
Let's praise God, who listened when I prayed.
Let's praise God, who is always kind.
May God's amazing grace be with you.
May God's robust peace be yours.
Let us worship our living God.
Let us worship together our God.
Will you pray with me? Loving God, we come before you offering you our praise. We look around and see the beauty of your creation, the dark purple of berries, the yellow of fresh corn, the green of leafy shade trees, the red of a neighborhood fox, the orange and pink of a brilliant sunset. We look around at humanity and marvel at the diversity of your children, every size, shape, color, age, and personality. You are amazing, God, and we give you praise. We're sorry, Lord, for the ways that we have not been good stewards of your creation, and for the ways that we have injured others because of our selfishness, our callousness, and our prejudices. Create in us clean hearts, Lord, and renew a right spirit within us. Cover us in the grace that you have promised in Jesus Christ, so that we may truly do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with you. We lift our voices to pray for those who need your healing touch, for those who are sick, and especially for those who are ill with the coronavirus here and around the world. We pray for those whose grief is fresh, feeling intensely the loss of a loved one. We pray for all who are struggling, Lord, emotionally, physically, financially, or spiritually. We pray too for our communities, our schools, and our families as we look to the fall with uncertainty and anxiety. We seek your direction, God, and your care for our churches, that we may be the head and heart, the hands and feet of Christ right here where we are. Thank you for looking with compassion on all of your people. We love you, Lord, and we unite our voices now in the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Hi, I'm Wendy, the pastor of the Dayton Church. It seems like not so long ago, I brought you a special message about this word. Quarantine. Just in case you've forgotten, here's a little refresher.
People of Venice came up with this idea. What if they made the ships, filled with all those treasures, put their anchors down a fair distance away from where most everyone lived, until they could make sure that folks on board weren't sick and all the germs were gone? And for how long? 40 days. In the old Italian language, the words for 40 days are quaranta giorni, which is where we get the word quarantine. Quarantine means 40 days.
Last time, I talked to you about the number 40 and how it appears time and time again throughout our Bibles. And how when it says 40, it doesn't actually mean just 40 days. It means a long stretch of time. Well, I am back with you today to share that it looks like this long stretch of time, especially here at church, is a lot longer than we hoped that it might be. In the church, we often call these long stretches of time wilderness periods. Like Jesus, in the wilderness without food or water for 40 days, facing down temptation. These periods of wilderness are kind of scary and lonely and even frustrating. Something keeps happening and you can't see when the end might be in sight. That is a wilderness period. And that is where we find ourselves right now. Even though we live in a place where all around us stores and restaurants might be in the process of opening back up, there are many places that are choosing not to. You might be wondering, why is it that church, of all places, might choose quarantine? Well, here's one way that we might be able to understand together.
Even though the practice of quarantine happened 600 or 700 years ago, the ways of passing infection from one person to the next have stayed the same. The only thing that's changed is that we know even more about how sickness spreads. The sickness that's here today is called the coronavirus because when you look at it under a microscope, the virus has lots of spiky things sticking out, like spikes on a crown. Something like the coronavirus doesn't come from outside of where we are from a ship. The virus is already here. While many people get sick and quarantine themselves because they know they have the virus, other people have the virus without being sick at all for a few days and can pass it to someone else without even realizing it. Our best scientists and doctors and nurses tell us that if we're not careful, it can accidentally spread from one person to the next in all kinds of different ways. Sometimes when someone with the virus touches something with germs on their hands or sneezes or coughs on it, the germs transfer to the surface and another person can touch that surface and manage to get the virus themselves. Here at church, this means we can't share hymnals or our Bibles, pass the offering plate, or even have communion like we usually do. Sometimes when someone who's sick and doesn't even realize it covers their mouth when they sneeze or cough, or doesn't wash their hands after they use the bathroom, and they shake someone's hand or give them a hug, the virus can pass from one person to the next. Here at church, this means that we can't pass the peace in the way we love to do, and we definitely can't hug each other, even if we want to celebrate something or make someone feel better because something sad happened, because we might make them sick. And as much as we like to eat together here at church, we shouldn't do that either.
Hey, cupcakes!
Cookies, brownies!
I really just need some coffee.
How do we get them off the table without touching anything?
How about we take a bite while standing over it?
What if you drool on a table?
I'll just hold my breath while I'm doing it.
Wait, you're gonna pass out! You passed out.
I'm gonna get coffee if it's the last thing I do. Ah! I burned myself. Now how do I get milk and sugar in here?
That's all pretty terrible. But worst of all, scientists tell us the most dangerous thing we can do together, even if we stay 6 feet apart, is sing.
Jesus loves me, this I know.
Even though it's invisible to our eyes, when we sing together, it's not just the sound that comes out. There is also a spray of droplets, particles, that come out as well. These particles are so light, they can remain suspended in the air, taking a very long time to fall to the ground. If you're standing close enough to someone, these droplets can fall on you. And if the droplets carry the virus, they can make you sick. And even a breeze or air conditioning can move the aerosol toward you. Here at church, this means for right now, we shouldn't sing together.
Jesus loves me, this I know.
No, no choirs and no hymns.
Glory be to the Father.
No, no responses like the Gloria Patri or the Doxology.
Our Father, who art in heaven.
Because aerosols are a problem when we all say the same thing at the same time, we probably shouldn't say the Lord's Prayer or any of what we put into bold print in the bulletin either. For how long do we go without these things? For the 40 days of the wilderness period, which we know can be some time to come.
So now we move from this word, quarantine, to a word that's even more challenging. Patience. Patience means having to hang on and hang in when all you really want to do is move forward. Patience can mean having to wait, even though all you want to do is rush ahead. Patience means bearing with something. It can mean supporting something. Sometimes it means suffering, but always it means enduring. You know, patience doesn't mean sitting back and doing nothing. This church, all churches, are doing the hard work of figuring out what needs to happen to keep everyone safe once we're all back together. Here's what I know for sure. You with ears to hear me, you are a beloved child of God. And here at church, in churches everywhere, we are making choices that ensure that you and everyone we know and love will be as safe
as we can be, and whole and healthy. So I'm asking you to hang on and hang in and be patient and know and trust that even though this wilderness period stretches beyond what we might have hoped, that there is a time out on the horizon, just beyond our sight, but still there, where we will come together again here in our beloved buildings. Amen.
Listen for the word of God in this story from the book of Genesis. This is the story of Jacob's family. When Jacob's son Joseph was 17 years old, he took care of the sheep with his brothers, the sons of Bilhah and Zilpah. But he was always telling his father all sorts of bad things about his brothers. Jacob loved Joseph more than he did any of his other sons, because Joseph was born after Jacob was very old. Jacob had given Joseph a fancy coat to show that he was his favorite son. And so Joseph's brothers hated him, would not be friendly to him. One day, Joseph told his brothers what he had dreamed, and they hated him even more. Joseph said, "Let me tell you about my dream. We were out in the field, tying up bundles of wheat. Suddenly, my bundle stood up, and your bundles gathered around and bowed down to it." His brothers asked, "Do you really think you're going to be king and rule over us?" Now they hated Joseph more than ever because of what he had said about his dream. Joseph later had another dream, and he told his brothers, "Listen to what else I dreamed. The sun, the moon, and 11 stars bowed down to me." When he told his father about this dream, his father became angry and said, "What's that supposed to mean? Are your mother and I and your brothers all going to come and bow down in front of you?" Joseph's brothers were jealous of him, but his father kept wondering about the dream.
Fortunately, Joseph was a bright and talented boy, blessed by God.
Unfortunately, Joseph knew how bright he was, and he told everyone he met.
Fortunately, Jacob loved Joseph very much.
Unfortunately, Jacob played favorites among his children, just the way his parents had. And unfortunately, Jacob's son saw enemies and schemes in what they didn't understand, just the way Jacob had when he was young.
Fortunately, Joseph was a good and obedient boy, even if he was a bit full of himself. When Jacob sent him out with his brothers, tending the sheep, he went.
Unfortunately, Joseph's brothers saw him coming, and they wanted to kill him. Well, all except his brother Reuben.
Reuben heard the brothers talking and intervened to save him. "We're not going to kill him. No murder. Go ahead and throw him in this cistern out here in the wild, but don't hurt him." Reuben planned to go back later and get him out and take him back to his father. When Joseph reached his brothers, they ripped off the fancy coat he was wearing, grabbed him, and threw him into a cistern. The cistern was dry. There wasn't any water in it. As they sat down to eat, they looked up and saw a caravan of Ishmaelites coming from Gilead. Their camels were loaded with all kinds of spices that they were taking to Egypt. So Judah said, "What will we gain if we kill our brother and hide his body? Let's sell him to the Ishmaelites and not harm him. After all, he is our brother." And the others agreed. By that time, the traders were passing by. His brothers pulled Joseph out of the cistern and sold him for 20 pieces of silver to the Ishmaelites, who took Joseph with them down to Egypt. When Reuben returned to the well and did not find Joseph there, he tore his clothes in sorrow. Then he went back to his brothers and said, "The boy is gone. What am I going to do?" They took Joseph's coat, butchered a goat, and and dipped the coat in the blood. They took the fancy coat back to their father and said, "We found this. Look it over. Do you think this is your son's coat?" He recognized it at once. "My son's coat. A wild animal has eaten him. Joseph torn limb from limb." Jacob mourned for Joseph a long time, and to show his sorrow, he tore his clothes and wore sackcloth.
Fortunately, Joseph was a bright and talented boy, blessed by God.
Unfortunately, Joseph's brothers hated how arrogant he seemed, and they were jealous of how their father played favorites.
Fortunately, Reuben couldn't bear to let Joseph be killed.
Unfortunately, while Reuben wasn't looking, his brothers sold Joseph into slavery. The traders took Joseph to Egypt, where he was sold to Potiphar, an Egyptian, one of Pharaoh's officials.
Fortunately, God was watching out for Joseph, and Joseph was becoming a bright and talented man, blessed by God. His new master noticed his fine work and put him in charge of the entire household.
Unfortunately, there were others who thought Joseph had other duties.
Joseph was a strikingly handsome man. As time went on, his master's wife became infatuated with Joseph and one day said, "Sleep with me." He wouldn't do it. "Look, with me here, my master doesn't give a second thought to anything that goes on here. He's put me in charge of everything he owns. He treats me as an equal. The only thing he hasn't turned over to me is you. You're his wife, after all. How could I violate his trust and sin against God?" She pestered him day after day after day, but he stood his ground. He refused to go to bed with her. One day, Joseph went to Potiphar's house to do his work, and none of the other servants were there. Potiphar's wife grabbed hold of his coat and said, "Make love to me." Joseph ran out of the house, leaving her hanging onto his coat. When this happened, she called in her servants and said, "Look, this Hebrew has come just to make fools of us. He tried to rape me, but I screamed for help." When his master heard his wife's story, telling him, "There are the things your slave did to me," he was furious. Joseph's master took him and threw him into the jail where the Pharaoh's prisoners were locked up. But there in jail, God was still with Joseph. God reached out in kindness to him and put him on good terms with the head jailer. The head jailer put Joseph in charge of all the prisoners. He ended up managing the whole operation.
Fortunately, Joseph was a bright and talented man, blessed by God.
Unfortunately, his master's wife thought she could take advantage of him.
Fortunately, Joseph was losing his arrogance, and he refused her advances.
Unfortunately, she then lied about him, and he landed in jail.
Fortunately, Joseph was a bright and talented man, blessed by God. The jailer noticed him and gave him a position of responsibility. When the Pharaoh's personal servant and chief cook were thrown in jail, Joseph was able to help them, especially when they had disturbing dreams.
When Joseph went to see the men, he could tell they were upset, and he asked, "Why are you so worried today?" "We each had a dream last night," they answered, "and there is no one to tell us what they mean." Joseph replied, "Doesn't God know the meaning of dreams? Now tell me what you dreamed." The Pharaoh's personal servant told Joseph, "In my dream, I saw a vine with three branches. As soon as it budded, it blossomed, and its grapes became ripe. I held the Pharaoh's cup and squeezed the grapes into it. Then I gave the cup to the Pharaoh." Joseph said, "Here's the meaning. Three branches are 3 days. Within 3 days, Pharaoh will get you out of here and put you back to your old work. You'll be giving Pharaoh his cup just as you used to do when you were his cupbearer. Only remember me when things are going well with you again. Tell Pharaoh about me and get me out of this place." When the chief cook saw that Joseph had given a good meaning to the dream, he told Joseph, "I also had a dream. In it, I was carrying three bread baskets stacked on top of my head. The top basket was full of all kinds of baked things for the Pharaoh, but birds were eating them." Joseph said, "This is the meaning of your dream. The three baskets are 3 days, and in 3 days, the Pharaoh will cut off your head. He will hang your body on a pole, and birds will come and peck at it." 3 days later, while the Pharaoh was celebrating his birthday with a dinner for his officials, he sent for his personal servant and the chief cook. He put the personal servant back in his old job and had the cook put to death. Everything happened just as Joseph had said it would. But the Pharaoh's personal servant completely forgot about Joseph. 2 years passed, and Pharaoh had a dream. He was standing by the Nile River. 7 cows came up out of the Nile, all shimmering with health, and grazed on the marsh grass. Then 7 other cows, all skin and bones, came up out of the river after them and stood by them on the bank of the Nile. The skinny cows ate the 7 healthy cows. Then Pharaoh woke up. He went back to sleep and dreamed a second time. 7 ears of grain, full-bodied and lush, grew out of a single stalk. Then 7 more ears grew up. But these were thin and dried out by the east wind. The thin ears swallowed up the full, healthy ears. Then Pharaoh woke up. Another dream. When morning came, he was upset. He sent for all the magicians and sages of Egypt. Pharaoh told them his dreams. They couldn't interpret them to him. The personal servant then spoke up and said to Pharaoh, "I just now remembered something. I'm sorry, I should have told you this long ago. When you were angry with me and your chief cook, you threw us both in jail, in the house of the captain of the guard. One night we both had dreams, and each dream had a different meaning. A young Hebrew, who was a servant of the captain of the guard, was there with us at the time. When we told him our dreams, he explained what each of them meant, and everything happened just as he said it would." Pharaoh at once sent for Joseph. They brought him on the run from the jail cell. He cut his hair, put on clean clothes, and came to Pharaoh. "I dreamed a dream," Pharaoh told Joseph. "Nobody can interpret it, but I've heard that just by hearing a dream, you can interpret it." Joseph answered, "Not I, but God. God will set Pharaoh's mind at ease. Pharaoh's 2 dreams both mean the same thing. God is telling Pharaoh what he's going to do. The 7 healthy cows are 7 years, and the 7 healthy ears of grain are 7 years. They're the same dream. The 7 sick and ugly cows that followed them up are 7 years, and 7 scrawny ears of grain dried out by the east wind are the same. 7 years of famine. So Pharaoh needs to look for a wise and experienced man and put him in charge of the country. Then Pharaoh needs to appoint managers throughout the country of Egypt to organize it during the years of plenty. Their job will be to collect all the food produced in the good years ahead and stockpile the grain under Pharaoh's authority, storing it in the towns for food. This grain will be held back to be used later during the 7 years of famine that are coming on Egypt. This way, the country won't be devastated by the famine.
Fortunately, Joseph was a bright and talented man, blessed by God.
Unfortunately, God's integrity landed him in jail.
Fortunately, Joseph didn't let that make him bitter, and he used the gifts God gave him where he was. He was in a position to use his gifts to help the Pharaoh's personal servant.
Unfortunately, the servant forgot what Joseph did for him.
Fortunately, Joseph was learning and maturing and had become patient. When the time was right, he was in a position to help Pharaoh. And Pharaoh put Joseph in charge of collecting and storing the grain and made him the second most powerful man in Egypt. Joseph was patient, and when the time was right, he was able to save the world.
Egypt's 7 years of plenty came to an end, and the 7 years of famine began, just as Joseph had said. There was not enough food in other countries, but all over Egypt there was plenty. When the famine finally struck Egypt, the people asked the Pharaoh for food, but he said, "Go to Joseph and do what he tells you to do." The famine became bad everywhere in Egypt, so Joseph opened the storehouses and sold the grain to the Egyptians. People from all over the world came to Egypt because the famine was severe in their countries. When Jacob learned that there was food in Egypt, he said to his sons, "Why do you sit around here and look at one another? I've heard that there is food in Egypt. Go down there and buy some so that we can survive and not starve to death." 10 of Joseph's brothers went down to Egypt to get food. Jacob didn't send Joseph's brother Benjamin with them. He was afraid that something bad might happen to him. So Israel's sons joined everyone else that was going to Egypt to buy food, for Canaan, too, was hit hard by the famine. Joseph was running the country. He was the one who gave out rations to all the people. When Joseph's brothers arrived, he treated them with honor, bowing to him. Joseph recognized them immediately, but treated them as strangers and spoke roughly to them. "Where do you come from?" "From Canaan," they said. "We've come to buy food." Joseph, remembering the dreams he had dreamed of them, said, "You're spies. You've come to look for our weak spots." "No, master," they said. "We've only come to buy food. We're all the sons of the same man. We're honest men. We'd never think of spying." He said, "No, you're spies. You've come to look for our weak spots." They said, "There were 12 of us, brothers, sons of the same father in the country of Canaan. The youngest is with our father, and one is no more." But Joseph said, "It's just as I said, you're spies." Then he threw them into jail for 3 days. On the third day, Joseph spoke to them. "Do this and you'll live. I'm a God-fearing man. If you're as honest as you say you are, one of your brothers will stay here in jail while the rest of you take the food back to your hungry families. But you have to bring your youngest brother back to me, confirming the truth of your speech, and not one of you will die." They agreed. Then they started talking among themselves. "Now we're paying for what we did to our brother. We saw how terrified he was when he was begging us for mercy. We wouldn't listen to him, and now we're the ones in trouble." Reuben broke in. "Didn't I tell you? Don't hurt the boy." "But no, you wouldn't listen. And now we're paying for his murder." The famine in Canaan got worse until finally Jacob's family had eaten all the grain they had bought in Egypt. So Jacob said to his sons, "Go back and buy some more grain." Judah replied, "The governor strictly warned us that we would not be allowed to see him unless we brought our youngest brother with us. If you let us take Benjamin along, we will go and buy grain." Their father Israel gave in. "If it has to be, it has to be. Take your brother and get going. Go back to the man. And may the strong God give you grace in that man's eyes, so that he'll send back your other brother along with Benjamin. For me, nothing's left. I've lost everything." They lost no time in getting to Egypt and meeting Joseph. When Joseph saw that they had Benjamin with them, he told his house steward, "Take these men into the house and make them at home. Butcher an animal and prepare a meal. These men are going to eat with me at noon." Then Joseph picked out his brother Benjamin, his own mother's son. He asked, "And this is your youngest brother that you told me about?" Then he said, "God be gracious to you, my son." deeply moved on seeing his brother and about to burst into tears, Joseph hurried out into another room and had a good cry. Then he washed his face, got a grip of himself, and said, "Let's eat." Later, Joseph told the servant in charge of his house, "Fill the men's grain sacks with as much as they can hold and put their money in the sacks. Also put my silver cup in the sack of the youngest brother." The servant did as he was told.
Fortunately, Joseph was a bright and talented man, blessed by God. He was able to not only help the world, but to help his family, who thought he was lost.
Unfortunately, his brothers were full of guilt, and Joseph was full of pain. He couldn't just come out and tell them who he was.
Fortunately, Joseph was still able to be generous with them.
Unfortunately, Jacob wasn't able to let go of Benjamin. Joseph had to wait.
Fortunately, Joseph's patience was rewarded.
Unfortunately, he still couldn't come out and tell them. He sent servants after them when they left, and the brothers were arrested with the chalice. They were confused and afraid and guilty and sure they were doomed.
Fortunately, Joseph's love finally overrode his old pain.
"Come closer to me," Joseph said to his brothers. They came closer. "I am Joseph, your brother, whom you sold into Egypt. But don't feel badly. Don't blame yourselves for selling me. God sent me here ahead of you to save lives. There's been a famine in the land now for 2 years. The famine will continue for 5 more years, neither plowing nor harvesting. God sent me on ahead to pave the way and make sure there was a remnant in the land, to save your lives in an amazing act of deliverance. So you see, it wasn't you who sent me here, but God. God set me in place as a father to Pharaoh, put me in charge of his personal affairs, and made me ruler of all Egypt. Hurry back to my father. Tell him, your son Joseph says, I am master of all Egypt. Come as fast as you can and join me here. I'll give you a place to live in Goshen where you'll be close to me. You, your children, your grandchildren, your flocks, your herds, and anything else you can think of. I'll take care of you there completely. There's still 5 more years of famine ahead. I'll make sure all your needs are taken care of, you and everyone connected with you. You won't want for a thing." Joseph's brothers left Egypt, and when they arrived in Canaan, they told their father that Joseph was still alive and was the ruler of Egypt. But their father was so surprised that he could not believe them. Then they told him everything Joseph had said. When he saw the wagons Joseph had sent, he felt much better and said, "Now I can believe you. My son Joseph must really be alive, and I will get to see him before I die."
Fortunately, Joseph was a bright and talented man, blessed by God. God used the terrible things that had happened to him to put him in a position to not only save Egypt, not only the world, but to save his family as well.
Unfortunately, bad things happen to us all every day. Just like with Joseph, some of them are due to the pain and the dishonesty of others. Some of them are due to our own arrogance, impatience, shortcomings.
Fortunately, God loves and blesses us just as much as Joseph. We can get past the pain, the fears, and the mistakes. We can get past generations of our family dysfunctions.
Unfortunately, there will always be troubles in life.
Fortunately, God will always use those troubles for good and will include us in the plan if we are patient and faithful, if we use our voices and our brains. Fortunately, every day, in dozens of ways, we can strengthen our relationships working with God and Along the way, in our small ways, we can save the world.
This is God's word for us today.
Let us pray. Write these words in our hearts, dear God, and help us, help them to grow in us the fruits of your Spirit, to honor and praise your name, to work with you and help your people. Through Christ our Lord we pray. Amen.
Morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for the springing fresh from the world. Sweet the rains, new fall, sunlit from heaven, like the first dewfall on the first grass. Praise for the sweetness of the wet garden, sprung in completeness where his feet pass. Mine is the sunlight, mine is the morning, born of the one light, Eden saw play. Praise with elation, praise every morning, God's recreation of the new day.
In the fullness of God's grace, we understand how we come together, how God uses us in the muckiness of our life, and how things change around us. We go forth to give that grace, to extend it to others. May the blessings of the triune God be with us now and forevermore. Amen. Go in peace.
Peace be with you.
Also with you.
Come through. grace to him.